So I'm very glad to be here to in San Francisco to present you our latest product at Free. So you probably do not know Free, so let me do a quick presentation. Free is actually one of the major French internet service providers. And we have more than 4 million users today, 4 million and a half even. And we are, since the beginning of the year, we've been deploying our set-top box to the users that features Qt and Qt Quick. So we are very proud of it. So let me show you first what offer we have in France for internet. So I don't know how much you pay in the US for internet access, but in France for about $50, you have a triple play service, so internet with unlimited download and bandwidth. You have HD IP television with hundreds of channels. And you have a telephony service too, so unlimited calls towards landlines and even mobile phones. So all of this is included in the $50 package. On top of this service, we also provide the hardware with in the package. So we provide two boxes actually. So they were designed by Philip Stark, and they are available since the beginning of 2011. And it took us at Free, 1 year and a half of development to make it available. So that includes hardware and software. We do everything ourselves. So I'll do a quick presentation of the first box. It's actually not very relevant to this presentation because it doesn't use Qt, but it's still important. It's the gateway, which provides internet connectivity. So it has ADSL and fiber connectivity. A hard drive that is centralized on the network and shared, which all the set-top boxes and the computers can access. And it also features Wi-Fi and acts as a desk base station. So this is the box that is interesting to us. This is the set-top box that you plug on your TV. And it features Intel hardware. So it's based on the Intel CE chip, which is an Atom core. And on top of this, with this chip, we also have a PowerVR SGX accelerator. It's actually the same chip that's used in the iPhone 4 for graphical rendering. So it's pretty powerful. We have our UI runs pretty well, even in 1080p. So you'll see that later. And this box also features a DVD and Blu-ray player, and it's always included in the standard package, sorry. And last, in the package, we also include the remote controller, which is radio-based. It features an accelerometer and a gyrometer, so we can emulate a mouse cursor with it. You just need to move your wrist like this, and you can move the cursor on the screen. So it's pretty useful for a web browser, for example, or for games. And we also provide a gamepad. So I'm going to do you a quick demo of the UI. It's based on Qt 4.7, like was introduced, and Qt Quick 1. So in the future, we of course want to update to Qt 5 and Qt Quick 2 because they are much more powerful and it will probably boost our performance. But let me show you what we can do with these technologies at the moment. So this is our home screen. So it's everything is implemented, as that I'm going to show, is implemented with QML. So it's pretty basic. It allows access to all our services and is easily accessed with the left and right arrows or up and down. So I'm going to show you the most important service at Free, at least on the TV. So it's television, of course. And we invested a lot of time on making channel zapping very fast. So here you see the result. And the UI is still implemented in QML. So right now, on screen, you can see the channel information. So you have the current program that is fetched over the network with JSON, which is actually very easy to use in QML because it's JavaScript-based. So parsing JSON is very easy. Here, on a single channel, you can do some actions like start a recording. So that's what I just did. And the recording just started on the server box, which has a hard drive, and it's running in the background. So, and since it's running on the server, it doesn't impact the user experience at all. You can also browse between the future programs and past programs with left and right. So everything is fetched over the network asynchronously, so it's very fast. And here I just shown you a single channel information. So more important is how do you browse between channels. So you just press up and down, and you have a list of the current channels displayed on screen. So we wanted this browsing to be very fast. So at first, we tried implementing it, this list in QML with a list view, but we found out that it was too slow. Not the rendering, actually, but the instantiation, the allocation of all elements, the delegates, was too slow. So instead, we re-implemented it in C++ directly, and it's actually pretty simple code, but it works pretty nicely. So we have some caching optimizations and object pre-allocation, and it works fine. Today, I guess we could rewrite it in QML directly with Qt Quick 2 because it's much faster. I hope we can try that in the very near future. Sorry. So I can show you all the features of the box. The video is actually very long, so I'm going to skip some of them. So here is the media player. Our media player is pretty simple. It still allows to browse files on the local network, UPnP servers, local disk connected to the box, and the hard drive on the server. And here I'm playing back a video directly on the box. And we implemented GStreamer plugins actually to leverage the Intel hardware, so it's working very nicely. And it doesn't cost any CPU to decode a video. So we are very happy with the result. We also have a partnership with a French equivalent for IMDb, so which is called Allociné, and provides information on a lot of TV series, movies. And we just, from the file name of the video, we try to guess the real name in the database. And so you can see, here it guessed the right choice. It's a Big Bang Theory. With you can see the casting information and the plot for the TV series. And if you want, you can actually show the detail of the casting for each actor in full screen or show the episode guide. So everything is done in QML too. And everything is loaded asynchronously on the network. Everything is JSON, I think. We don't use XML at all. Okay. So I'll skip the audio player presentation and the pictures presentation because it's not very interesting. Next is the Free Store. So it's actually an application store. Right now it's a little limited because we don't have an open SDK that the users can use. But we have partnerships with Gameloft, which is very well known on iPhone and Android. So we have a lot of their games. And we also have a partnership with Gumtree TV. So they have games like Plant vs. Zombie or World of Goo, which are playable with mouse cursor. But we emulate that with a remote controller, so it's very easy to play. The games are actually not using Qt, but the free stories. And last, I wanted to show you our web browser. So it was pretty easy to implement, actually, because of Qt WebKit. We use Qt WebKit 2.2 and the QML WebView. So with those tools, we actually made the browser very, very, very quickly. So it's pretty simple. We have a history of pages. We have the favorites, tabbed browsing. And it was pretty easy to implement with QML. And it's actually pretty fast. We also have a Flash plugin, Flash 10.1. So right now the scrolling is a little slow on this page. It's not the best example because there are 3 or 4 animations on this page. But you'll see later that on a page with less animations, it's much faster. So we also implemented a virtual keyboard to be able to type URLs or things like that. Right now, it's not very well done because it's actually implemented directly in the QML application. It's not a system-wide keyboard, but it does the job for now. We are changing it right now. It's a little slow because of there are so many elements to display on screen. I hope it will be better with Qt Quick 2 with the SynGraph. But in the end, it works fine. So, and if you don't like the virtual keyboard, you can plug a real keyboard or real mouse, and it will work fine. We also have iPhone and Android applications that can be interacted with the Freebox to allow you to emulate a cursor or a keyboard. So with your phone, you can do everything you can do with a remote or a keyboard or a mouse. Okay, so that's it for the demo. I'm sorry I can't show you everything, but we have so much to show that I chose only the main features. I didn't show the Blu-ray player either because it's not written in Qt, so, but it was a lot of work too. So how did we come to use Qt on the Freebox? We started development of the software stack in late 2009. And we had a lot of choices available to us for technologies to build a UI. So at first, we looked at the available complete software platforms like MIMO at the time, and Android too. But we found out that they weren't mature enough. For example, for Android, you only had x86. You didn't have x86 support, and there were no TV APIs. So right now, they are starting to make it work with our Google TV platform, but it was way too early for us to use Android at the time. So instead, we looked at available toolkits. So we looked at the Enlightenment Foundation libraries, and we were very pleased with the performance of these libraries, mainly for rendering. But even though there were a WebKit backend for the EFLs, we found out that building a UI wasn't as quick as with Qt, and mainly Qt Quick. So in 2009, Qt Quick was still experimental. It was, I don't remember if it was still an experimental branch or in master, but it wasn't stable at all. So we took a big risk in investing in this technology. But in the end, we are very pleased we chose it. It was very promising, so we were sure Nokia would push for it. So what are the main incentives in using Qt Quick? So we found out that our designers actually can do a mock-up of the UI in QML directly using Qt Creator without us helping them. You have the QML designer, which helps a lot. And we even found out that our designers can write some code in QML directly and take some load off of us when designing a UI. So it's very efficient. And Qt Quick also provides all the base elements we need to render data. So we have lists, grids, everything we've shown before is actually implemented with base elements, so it's perfect. And now we even have QML debuggers and profilers. We didn't have that at the time, but it's still a bonus, so it's perfect. So when we chose to use Qt on our platforms, we had multiple choices to port it on our hardware. So the first choice was, of course, Qt X11, which was the standard Linux backend at the time. But the problem is that in the Intel SDK, we don't have X11, sorry, and we don't even have a full OpenGL. So this choice was not actually a choice for us. We also could have used Qt Embedded, which was standard way of implementing a new platform at the time. It also featured OpenGL-ES, so it was perfect for us, except that we also needed window compositing, which is done with QWS, but we also need to support non-Qt apps. So I'm not sure when I say that, but I don't think it's possible to do that with QWS. So we ruled out this possibility. And at the time, we saw the experimental Lighthouse backend was starting. So it's actually now called QPA and is available in Qt 4.8 and Qt 5, which is exactly what we needed. It allows you to port your architecture directly on Qt very quickly. So we merged the Lighthouse branch and the 4.7 branch, and we saw that it was working, so we used it. And we also needed a compositor. We couldn't use X11, as I told you, so we chose Wayland. It was still experimental too at the time, but it was exactly what we needed. So it doesn't do everything you would need on a desktop, but it's exactly what we needed. So simply display a few windows on screen, in full screen, so it was easy to implement a Wayland backend for Lighthouse. Today, when we update to Qt 5, it will be much simpler because QPA is already merged and supported, and there's already a Wayland, standard Wayland backend. So we will switch to those backends. It will be much standard, and it will be much more powerful, I think. So what problems did we have when we designed our UI for our set-top box? The main problem on TV is that you have to support multiple resolutions. Usually on a mobile device, you only have to support one screen, one resolution, so it's easy. When your application runs on the device, you know it will always work. It's not the case on TV, because you have to support on a single TV. The user can choose either full HD, HD, PAL, or NTSC. So completely different resolution, not always the same aspect ratio. You see in PAL, it's 4:3 aspect ratio, whereas in other resolutions, it's 16:9. So that means when you develop an application, you must make sure that it works in all resolutions and in all aspect ratios. And on top of that, on a TV, you have something called overscan, which is still used by today's TVs, so LCDs. I don't know why they use it still. But it's very annoying to develop a UI because the TV actually crops the size of the video content. The problem is that this cropping is not fixed. You never know how much the TV will crop. I've seen some old TVs, very old actually, that crops perhaps 20% of the content. Yeah, it's enormous. So on this example, you see, if we didn't take overscan into account, the TV information would be cropped a little, and the logo is just in the displayed area. You see, because TV channels know there is cropping on the TV, so they put their logo exactly where they need to avoid it being hidden. So we need to take all those considerations into account when we write our UI. So you have two solutions to fix this problem. The first solution is very simple. You just render your UI in a single fixed resolution, like 720p, and then you scale the UI to the display resolution. The problem with that is that the scaling algorithm is usually not perfect, so when you scale, the result will be a little blurry, not very sharp, so the text wouldn't look very good. And if the aspect ratio between the original content and the display is not the same, you would either have to add black bars to your content, so not really good, or to stretch the content, so it's not good either. So instead, we chose the hard solution, which is to make sure all your applications are scalable and work in a few resolutions and different aspect ratios. So let me show you a little demo of how this works. So here I'm going to, on this video. I'm going in the overscan adjustment screen. So you can actually change the. You need to make sure the border on your TV are always visible. So you must be able to show to see the white corners on your TV. If you see them, it means that you see every part of the UI. So I don't know if you've seen it, but when I move the corner to the left, you actually see that the text on the center is getting smaller and is being relayouted. So that's also why we chose Qt, because it's very dynamic and the UI can be relayouted, very easily. So there are good practices in QML to make sure that your UI is scalable. You need to always use anchors, so make sure that every element is placed and sized relative to its parent or siblings. So that makes layouting much easier. And you also need to make sure that every coordinate you or font size you set is independent of the display resolution. So in QML, it's hard to do, because in the parser, QML only supports pixels. So when you set a number on a coordinate or a size, you specify it in pixels. Android or Silverlight has extensions to support that. They have a device independent unit, which depends on DPI, actually. So that means when on a unit you add a DP unit, your UI will scale much more easily when the display resolution changes. In QML, it's not possible to do it. Well, it is possible, but not very cleanly. You have to add a function. They did it in Qt components on a function call on each coordinate that will calculate the final pixel value dependent on the DPI or display resolution. So we did fix this problem, but it's not as clean as it could be. So I'm quickly going to present you another issue we fixed in our system. We actually needed to expose every system API to the QML. So instead of writing custom C++ element, we generated the code for all this API. So we need to interact with display, audio, network, and everything directly in the UI. And for that, we designed our architecture of the on the box to be very common for every system task. So each system task is actually a server that has a Dbus API. And from this API, we generate the command line interface, we generate a C library, and we generate the QML plugin. So it's very simple to make our system task available to the UI or make each system task communicate with another. So here is a quick example. I have a display API with an enabled property to enable or disable display. So the generated QML bindings will allow you to call in your QML code display enable get or enable set, very simply. So it's not actually a declarative code, so not very suited for QML. So if you need, you can build a display element on top of this. So you just add a property enabled like we saw before. And on the element instantiation, you get the value from the system task and set it. And when you see the user changes the enabled value on the QML element, you just forward the value to the system task. So it's very elegant, I think, and more above all, much faster than writing QML, the C++ plugins by hand. So we have some future plans, of course. We update our firmware very, very often. So in the future, we want to update to Elan. Actually, we use a very old version right now, and I'm working on making it more up to date. And once we do that, we will build we will update to Qt 5 and hopefully Qt Quick 2. And we hope it will be much faster. So rendering will be much faster. We have some performance issues in 1080p, mainly on the TV channel list and very big grid views. So we hope switching to Qt Quick 2 will help with that. We might also consider implementing Qt components for Freebox, because the API is actually very close to what we do. We also have a concept of pages like they have, page stack. We have exactly the same. We have the device independent function to calculate coordinates. But we miss the standard widgets like tabs and everything. So implementing them on Qt components will probably help us to make our UI development even faster. And when after we have done that, we'd also like to implement to open an SDK to users so that they can write their own QML applications and make it available in the free store. So with the help of the Qt creator and developer, it should be very easy, actually, because they have plugins in Qt creator that allows deployment of QML application on a box, a standard Linux system. So I hope it will work fine. So these are the roads we are taking right now. So I'm sorry I couldn't show you the whole UI. If you want, I can give you the whole video if you want. I couldn't also bring a live demo, a live system, because it only works in our network. So I'm sorry I couldn't show everything. So that's it. Thank you.